Well, how's everybody doing tonight? Everything okay? What's the best thing that's happened to you today besides getting out of bed? That may not have been the best thing, but anything?
Getting off work.
Getting off work. That is better than, yeah, that is good. You got a $10, did you win it, or what?
They gave it to me for my trouble.
Oh, so you had trouble at the grocery store, and then as a result, it was worth a $10 gift card. Well, that's good. So it's kind of a mixed, okay, well, that's good, that is good. All right, well, if you remember from last week, I told you this week we're going to start a little different series. We're going to be looking at major messages from the minor prophets. Oh my God. Because, you know, we don't really talk about those minor prophets very much. We do a lot of Jesus stories, a lot of those Old Testament stories, but not a lot of, and we're not going to go into detail in every little sentence and all that, but we're going to be looking in the next several weeks over four different of the minor prophets. But we're going to first start with an Old Testament review, okay? Just to, so tell me this, how many books are in the Bible? 66, that is correct. All right, how many books are in the Old Testament? 30. You got a 1 in 9 chance here. 1 in 10, actually. 39 is correct. Somebody counted up in the... 39 is correct. Now, I think I've shared this before, but this is just an easy way to remember that. How many letters are in the word old? How many letters are in the word testament? 39, got it? Okay. Oh, yeah, click. The light bulb's going off here, isn't it? All right. All right, how many books are in the New Testament? If there's 66 minus 39, it's? Okay, how many books are in the New Testament? That's Old Testament's 39. 27. How many letters in the word new? How many letters in the word testament? 3 times 9 is? 27. There you go. It's Old Testament review and a math review all at once. There you go. All right. Well, yeah, go ahead and put that next screen up there. This is a breakdown of the Old Testament, okay? And it's kind of neat to me because there's this little pattern here, right? You've got law and history, right? So the laws, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, right? Then you got those 12 history books, the Samuels, the, you know, all those, Ezra and all that. So you got those, 7 and 12, that adds up to 17. And you got 5 books of poetry. And then you got prophets. You got 5 major and 12 minor. So you got the 5:12, the 5:12, the 17, and the 5 in the middle. Now, so that's the order of the Old Testament, except in the poetry you have Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, and then you have the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and then Lamentations. Lamentations is considered poetry, so it's not exactly in that order. But you've got 4 poetry, you get in the major prophets, and then they throw in Lamentations because it's Jeremiah's book. So anyway, I always thought that was kind of neat to see that pattern of the Old Testament. All right, so major and minor prophets. Now, why are some called major prophets and some are called minor prophets? Are Ezekiel and Daniel, are they so much more important that they're major guys, and folks like Hosea, well, they're, you know, not as important, so they're minor. That is right, Mr. Tim. Major prophet books are big. I was looking, it depends on your Bible and the print size, but in my Bible that I'm using here tonight, the major prophets usually take up about 50 or 60 pages, okay? Minor prophets can take as little as 2 or 3 pages, just depending on the prophet. And some of them are, of course, a little bit longer than that. So that's the difference in major and minor prophets. It's not the importance, it's the length of the book. And so you've got those 5 major and 12 minor prophets there. All right, so for the upcoming 12 weeks, we're going to be looking in depth at 4 different minor prophets. We're going to be looking at Amos. That's where we're going to be tonight, if you want to be finding that. Amos. We'll be looking at Jonah. We'll be looking at Hosea. And be looking at Micah. And like I said, we really don't spend a lot of occasional. Sometimes there's some Sunday school lessons. We don't have a lot of sermons. They're usually New Testament sermons, and that's great. But anyway, I just thought it'd be good to do a little digging in the Old Testament, some of these minor prophets. So if you're looking, if you're not punching it into your phone and bringing it up, so it's, of course, after Psalms. If you're looking for Hosea, so you get Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel. Then you get into the minor prophets, Hosea, Joel, and then Amos. So as you're coming across that, if you hit Obadiah, you've gone too far. Go back. All right, so as you're looking at that, let's look at this next slide here. And what do all of these things have in common? Warnings, yes, warnings. That's exactly right. They all warn of potential danger, right? You got the railroad crossing. There's a train coming. You certainly don't want to cross the tracks. You know, you've got the tornado siren. You got the blood pressure monitor, and then the check engine light as well. So whether it's a health issue or a light that shows up on your dashboard, you know, here's the thing: just noticing it. You hear the tornado siren going off at 2 o'clock in the morning, and it wakes you up and you say, oh, there's the tornado siren. And then you go back to sleep, if you can. Or if you see the check engine light come on, you say, oh, that's a nice light. That's the thing about these warnings. You can heed them or not heed them, right? The warnings call us to do something. The warnings call us to action. So let me tell you this story. When we were in Liberal, Kansas at our first church, I'd pulled up onto the parking lot one day, and the car died. I just kind of coasted. Luckily, I was in the parking lot and wasn't out on the street. And I tried starting it, and I got the pastor. He came out, and he started. We tried jumping. You know, it was turning over. It just wasn't starting. So I called, had a guy that in our church that worked down at the local Chevy place, and they came and towed it down there and looked, and I got the bill. And I think it was $105 or something like that. And $100 of that was towing and looking, and the other five was putting a gallon of gas in the car. Yeah. See, this problem has been with me for decades, okay? It's nothing new. It's not you guys. I've had it for decades. And I suppose the little light probably came on, but my pastor didn't look at that either, so I'm blaming him as much. Yeah, I got to blame somebody. Now, what are some reasons that drivers like me or others ignore those dashboard warnings? Yeah, we're in a hurry. I'll take care of that later. Yeah, what else?
You run over by a train if you don't want to.
Yeah.
That's the one you better.
Yeah. That's right, yeah. It's going to cost me money to fix. Of course, you know, the other side is if it breaks down, it's probably going to cost me more money. But I'll give you another story, and this is a little bit better than that last one. So soon after I got my pickup, my check engine, or the tire pressure light came on, and I kept checking. I was like, oh, my tires are the same, and they're decent pressure. I don't know what's going on, so I took it in, and well, it was an indicator. The indicator had gone out, so we'll go ahead and replace it. Well, that's like $115. Well, now if my indicator light comes on, I ain't taking it in. I'll check the pressure, but I'm not taking it in and having them charge me $115. And Mr. Harper's not here for me to gripe about that either. So anyway, so automobiles, you know, they have all these kind of warning lights that are built into the dash, you know, the check engine and the tire pressure and seat belts and all that stuff. And they're helpful. They're very helpful, but the driver has to pay attention to those warnings. That's why they're there. I guess they're called idiot lights for a reason, aren't they? Calls us to action. And so these minor prophets are acting kind of like dashboard lights. They are they are indicators of warning for the people of Israel and Judah. And they're signaling, they're warning about impending judgment. But still, it's one thing to hear it, and it's another thing to listen, to heed, and to act on it. And so that was the responsibility of the people of Israel and Judah. So as you think about them, we can think about them thousands of years ago, but let's think about us. What are some reasons that Christians ignore God's warnings? We sometimes get those little indicator lights. We sometimes get that little Holy Spirit nudge, right? What are some reasons that we would ignore those warnings? Too busy, okay. I'm sorry? Listening to other sources, other, having competing voices coming at us, right? And we have God talking to us, and then we also hear these other things. And what did you say? To do whatever God wants us to do might be a little painful for us. Yeah, that's right. Also, maybe, I'm sorry, Pat? A pride issue, could be a pride issue. And if it's maybe something you're doing you shouldn't be doing, maybe you've gotten by with it for a while. Right? You've gotten by with it, nothing's really happened. Well, I can get by with it another time, right? We think those kind of things. Or maybe, well, just this once, then I'll go back to doing right. So, you know, we got all these excuses that we can use for that. So tonight, as we begin studying Amos, we're going to be looking at the timelessness of his message. You know, yeah, the message was for a few thousand years ago, but the message is timeless as well. It's for the people back then, but it's also for us as well. So don't know how familiar you are with Amos, but do you know, is there a particular theme? Is there a one-word theme that comes to mind when you think of Amos? Besides the Jerry Reed song, Amos Moses. Well, let's look at this picture here. All right, so what do we have here? We have, what kind of animal is that? It is a moose. A moose. Amos. It's a moose. And what's he holding? He's holding a plumb line. Now, what's the purpose of a plumb line? Yeah, make sure it's straight. I was looking around the office trying to find something to make a plumb line with, and I didn't have much luck, so I got my trombone mouthpiece and a piece of red yarn. Yeah, isn't that pretty? And so that's kind of what that does, right? Now, when a plumb line shows you what's plumb, right? It shows you what's up and down, vertical. And why would you use this? Why would a person use this? It's used by whom? By carpenters, by builders, right? To show if the wall's plumb, right? Now, the plumb line never does this, right? Never does that. It always is plumb. And so we'll be looking at this in a few weeks when we get down to where Amos is talking about the plumb line. But another thing about the plumb line is the plumb line doesn't change because the carpenter wants to do something different. The plumb line is always plumb. It's always because of gravity. It's always going to do that. And everything that your work has to line up with that. If not, what's going to happen? Things are going to be crooked. They're going to be out of plumb, right? Not level, whatever. So God has a plumb line, right? What is God's plumb line for us? Yes, that is exactly right. It is his word. That's plumb line for us. And back in these days, they had some writings. They had God's word that came through them to the prophets as well. And Israel didn't line up to it. They didn't line up with God's word at the time. And as a result, they were way out of kilter with what God was asking him, telling him to do. So Amos begins his prophecy with this warning for the nations, and that God's judgment is awaiting them, awaiting all them who ignore him and his truth. And after he lists a bunch of nations, Amos then addresses his own people. Now Amos was, let's just do a little geography lesson. I think most of us know this, but just to make sure. So we've got Israel as a whole, but the northern kingdom was composed of 10 tribes, right? And that was Israel. Then you have the bottom two tribes of the 12, 10 and 2. The bottom two tribes, or the southern two tribes, were called what? Judah, right? So you got Israel and you got Judah. Now, Amos was from a little place called Tekoa in Judah, but he was called to go up to Israel to prophesy there. And the time here that we're talking about, it was a time of economic prosperity. It was a time of peace there for both kingdoms, actually. And we'll see that here in chapter 1, Amos addresses the surrounding nations and before he turns to Israel and to Judah and Israel. Here's the thing. The people appeared to be very religious, but their lives did not reflect devotion to God. Instead of their lives reflecting their devotion to God, they were reflecting the surrounding nations, the pagan nations around them. All right, so we're in Amos. I'm just going to read the very first verse here. The words of Amos, one of the shepherds of Tekoa, the vision he saw concerning Israel 2 years before the earthquake, when Uzziah was king of Judah and Jeroboam, son of Joash, was the king of Israel. All right. A lot of information is packed into that verse. You know, you can read through that and just kind of skim over it. Yeah, that's just some introduction. But we learned a lot. We get a timeline here. So we've got a historical document. This isn't some fairy tale made up. No, we have a historical timeline of when this happened. 2 years before the earthquake. I don't know what earthquake that was, but it was important back then, so that was something they could pinpoint to. And then you've got these kings. Uzziah, king of Judah, Jeroboam, king of Israel. Now, Uzziah, does that king's name sound familiar? In another prophet, in Isaiah 6:1, he had the vision the year that King Uzziah died, right? So that kind of puts him there, contemporary there with Isaiah. All right, the book of Amos begins here, and it tells us three different things. It tells us who he is, right, who the book's named for. He's from Tekoa. Tekoa is just this little town about 6 miles south of Bethlehem, about 10 miles south of Jerusalem. What's his occupation? He's a shepherd, okay. That's really all we know about him. That's all we know about our friend here, Mr. Amos. It tells us some things about the time in which his ministry occurred. We talked about this, about the earthquake and Uzziah, Jeroboam, all that. So this is around the years 760 to 755 BC, somewhere in that area. Now, this is, even though it's a time of peace in Judah and Israel, it's also a time of disunity between Israel and Judah, because the fathers of these two kings, it would be Joash and Amaziah, they had been at war with each other, kind of like our war, or civil war almost. You know, you had the two kingdoms, and they were at odds with each other. And Israel, in the north, they was victorious, and so it resulted in kind of a cold war. It was peaceful, but it was a frigid peace between these two nations. And so it was a time there, like I said, of economic prosperity, a time of military superiority for the northern kingdom. And these two things led many to believe, the economic prosperity, the military superiority, that led folks to believe that things are great for us. God must be smiling down on us, right? Things are great, so God must be pleased. But they were mistaken. They were mistaken in that. And what resulted was a great deal of religious activity in Israel, but they replaced their sincere devotion to God with insincere religiosity, okay? In Isaiah 29:13, then Jesus repeats this in Matthew 15:8, these people honor me with their lips, but what? Their heart's far from me. And so that's what's happening here, is that, you know, they're saying, yeah, we worship Yahweh, we worship the Lord, but they're not acting like it, okay? They did not see their need, their sinfulness, didn't see their need for repent. Of course, they felt that they were all right with God, when in reality, they were really close to danger here, and they were actually far from him, and they had actually become more like the surrounding nations than they were supposed to be reflecting God. So it was in this context that God calls Amos out of Judah to go to Israel, a southerner, to go up north and preach about their impending doom. Now, let's put this, it's not a contemporary really, but it's more along our lines of thinking. Let's say 5 years after the Civil War, 1870, we have a preacher from Atlanta that goes up to Yankee land, and preaches about their impending doom. How well is that going to go over? It's not. Because these guys are victorious, right? The North has won the war. What are you doing? What are you doing coming up here talking to us? You know? And so you just kind of that kind of helps me, in my mind, set kind of the feel, the context for what Amos is probably going to have to go through here. Also, in this just this one sentence here, it reveals the nature of his message. All right. Actually, that happens on down a little bit further in into the chapter. Now, we don't know much about how the Old Testament prophets proclaim their message. You know, was it open air? I kind of see that, the kind of standing out in the street and they're talking, you know, preaching. Don't know if that's the case or not. But here in the rest of the chapter, he goes through all these surrounding nations and talks about the impending disaster that's going to come to them and how sinful they are. So if you picture Hosea out street corner preaching, whatever, and he's doing this, and he's talking about these surrounding nations, these enemy nations, and how God's going to judge them and all that. That gets folks' attention, right? These are our enemies. Yeah, yeah, we're for that. Yeah, yeah, we want that to happen, right? And he talks about Damascus and Gaza, Tyre, Edom, and Ammon, all these different nations, makes these pronouncements. And so I can see people hearing that, stopping, wanting to hear more, wanting to hear how they're going to get punished. But, you know, that's not all the story. And so he continues here in chapter 2. So let's look in chapter 2 of Amos. let's see here. Yeah, that continues on here with Moab. We get down here to verse 4. Verse 4. This is what the Lord says. For three sins of Judah, and even for four, I will not relent, because they have rejected the law of the Lord and have not kept his decrees, because they have been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed. I will send fire on Judah that will consume the fortresses of Jerusalem. Now remember, Jerusalem's in that southern kingdom. It's in Judah. And if you look back, if you just glance through chapter 1, you can see that's his pattern for three sins of Moab or Gaza or Damascus, whatever, and for four, and he lists a bunch of the things that are going on. So that's, he starts and he does these surrounding nations, and then he does Judah. It's like, yeah, yeah, we beat Judah. Yeah, yeah, they're no good, right? Now, this three sins, even for four, a common phrase here in the book, used eight times here in this book. And it's interesting, it's not really followed by four specific sins. It's usually just one or two sins. But, you know, three represents this fullness, this completion of, you know, yeah, they're sinful. And four, they're even overflowing with it. So that's kind of the literary use here that Amos is doing. And so what are the charges here against Judah? Well, they've rejected the law of the Lord. They've not kept his decrees. They've been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed. And so, like I said, as they heard these words of condemnation against Judah, they probably didn't think too much about it, maybe even some cheers. Yeah, that's right. You know, they shouldn't do that. But here's the thing, as he circled around the nations and he's getting down here to Judah, it's like that noose, and the noose is just getting tighter because he's getting ready to really, really pull it tight on him. We're going to see that here in verses 6 through 8. All right, Amos 2, 6 through 8. This is what the Lord says for three sins of Israel. Whoop, whoop, that's us. Yeah, three sins of Israel, even for four, I will not relent. They sell the innocent for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. They trample on the heads of the poor and as on the dust of the ground and deny justice to the oppressed. Father and son use the same girl and so profane my holy name. They lie down beside every altar on garments taken in pledge. In the house of their God, they will drink wine taken as fines. Well, now he's starting to step on some toes here with the northern folks in Israel. So let's remember here that Israel and Judah, they're both having this time of peace and prosperity, And God's judgment's really the furthest thing from their mind, because Jewish theology was, if things are going well, if it's peaceful, if we're being prosperous, then this is God's blessing. He's smiling on us, and we're tight with God, right? And so if we're enjoying this good life, God must be pleased. But as Amos tells them, that's not the case. So he lists these sins, that they're present sins. These are sins that are happening right now. Talks about injustice, about taking advantage of poor people, selling the innocent for silver, the needy for a pair of sandals. You know, there's those who couldn't even afford shoes. Their debts weren't forgiven. They were denying justice to the poor, to the oppressed. Sounds like the crooked judges, kind of the good old boy system going on there. Injustice, immorality, another sin here. Father and son sleeping with the same woman. Now, is this prostitute, incest, whatever it was, either way, you know, whatever it is, it's wrong. You shouldn't be doing that. Got injustice, immorality, idolatry. Wealthy folks taking garments as pledges against loans, but not returning them. Now, here's one of those Jewish laws from back in the book of Moses. You know, you take a garment as a pledge, what are you supposed to do with it? You're supposed to give it back at nighttime, because they use that for a blanket or whatever, you know. It's not like us that have a closet full of clothes. Right? So it's kind of like a day pledge, right? You give it for a day and you give it back. They were keeping them, taking them to these pagan altars, getting drunk on wine, and then sleeping on these garments there at the altar. And the list keeps going on and on here in upcoming verses. Here's the thing. The message of judgment, and it's not stated here, but it will be. The message of judgment isn't just a message of total annihilation here with God's people. It's a judgment with hope. And we'll be seeing that in the future weeks. See, the people of God had reverted back to their old way of life, to this prior to their knowledge of God, the God of their ancestors, gods of their ancestors. And Amos sounds this warning that their sins, they're not going to go unpunished. You know, why do you think God doesn't just zap them or correct them right when it happens? You know, this has been going on for some time. And it's the same thing with us, right? We get by with stuff, get by with stuff, get by with stuff. Why doesn't God just zap us and correct us right then? Yeah. Yeah, it's not like we have a spiritual shock collar on us, you know, and every time we're out of line, you know, he pushes the zapper button. It's not like that at all. Yeah, God is slow to anger, right? He wants us to, like you said, Terry, wants us to come to that knowledge of repentance. All right, so after listing their present sins that they have been committing, he then continues and reminds them of their past glory. Okay, let's look at that. In verses 9 through 11. Okay, you're talking about all those bad things that they've been doing. Yet, in verse 9, yet I destroyed the Amorites before them, though they were as tall as the cedars and strong as the oaks. I destroyed their fruit above and their roots below. I brought you out of Egypt and led you 40 years in the wilderness to give you to the land of the Amorites. I also raised up prophets from among your children and Nazirites among your youths. Is this not true, people of Israel? Declares the Lord. So Amos calls these people to remember the good things that God's done for them in the past. First, God allowed them, he enabled them to defeat the Amorites. This is referring to the enemy, or to the entire population of the land of Canaan. And so when the Israelites entered the promised land, Amos likens the height of them to what? Cedar trees, and the strength of them to oaks. That's right. So the Israelites were intimidated, right? When they first went into the land, they came back and said, man, we're just like grasshoppers around here. And so nevertheless, God defeated them. That was 40 years later after that spy incident on behalf of his people. But not only did he defeat the Amorites, then he removed them completely as a threat to Israel. He talks about the destruction of their fruit above and the roots below. That's kind of like head to toe. I mean, everything I got rid of them. delivered them from slavery, right? They were slaves in Egypt. They were just property. They were slaves, forced to work, but God delivered them out of that bondage, led them through the wilderness. What were the two things he led them by? What hell would he lead them by at nighttime? The fire at night, and what was the cloud during the day, right? And you have some secretaries that follow that same line today, right? They work in the cloud all day, and they're on their Kindle Fire at night. So there you go. I set you up for that one, didn't I? Yeah. All right. So then after being in Egypt for hundreds of years, God kept his promise to Abraham, his descendants, and gave them that land. And then he gives them spiritual leaders. He gives them these Nazarites. These are prophets sent from God to... I've said that wrong. He gave them spiritual leaders. First, he sent them prophets, right? He sent them prophets to proclaim his message. And then also, he sent them Nazarites. Now, Nazarites were spiritual leaders given to Israel, not necessarily to communicate a message like a prophet would, but to show how separate they were, how they were supposed to be separate people. And some became Nazarites as a vow made by their parent, like Hannah did for her son, who? Samuel, right? And then in Samson's case, another Nazarite, a messenger of the Lord visited Samson's mother while she was still barren and told her, your son will be a Nazarite. And so the Nazarite vow came with several prohibitions. They were supposed to abstain from anything that came from the vine, especially from alcohol. And this contrasts with the surrounding pagan cultures that included drunken feasts. Okay, so just another way to be separate here. They also did they cut their hair? They shaved their head? What did they do? No, they weren't supposed to cut their hair at all. That's right. You know, they're supposed to let it grow. Just think of Samson, right? And that was in contrast to a lot of the pagan cultures that would shave their heads. Now, don't tell that to our pastor, okay? But, we don't want him to think that we think he's a pagan or anything like that. Also, they were to avoid contact with the dead, right? Symbolizing that they were worshiping the one true living God. And then that contrasts with some of the pagan practices of necromancy. They also abstained from unclean food, demonstrating their consecration to the Lord. And so he concludes this little part here by listing the things that the Lord's done for Israel. He lists those things, and then he says, is this not true, people of Israel? Right? In other words, you know, they couldn't plead ignorance when it came to the history of God's dealing with his people. They knew what God had done for them. They knew why. And as a result, really, they have no excuse for their actions. You know, God is full of grace, and he desires for his people to be made right with him. But here the Israelites, and we'll see this as we go through, they really don't have any desire to hear God's message at all. Well, let's look on 12 through 16 here in chapter 2, starting in verse 12. Okay, we're going back to those Nazarites again. But you made the Nazarites drink wine and command the prophets not to prophesy. Now then, I will crush you as a cart crushes when loaded with grain. The swift will not escape. The strong will not muster their strength. The warrior will not save his life. The archer will not stand his ground. The fleet-footed soldier will not get away. And the horseman will not save his life. Even the bravest warriors will flee naked on that day, declares the Lord. Well, goodness, you know, he starts off talking bad about all the surrounding nations in Judah, but man, he's really laying it on here on Israel. It says here the Lord gave the Nazarites to... Wait, where am I at here? I think I lost my place. I did lose my place. Hold on. Sorry about that. Okay. It's terrible when you can't understand your own notes. You know, that is bad, isn't it? Okay. Verse 12. Okay, there we go. I got it. I'm with you. You know, I told you, I haven't been like this, or I have been like this all my life, right? You know, the gas light on in the car, all that stuff. It's nothing new. All right, so verse 12 highlights this very important truth here, that people who rebel against God, they're going to oppose those who live for God. So you got people in Israel rebelling against God. They don't like it when the Nazarites are trying to keep their vows and trying to keep this pure life of abstaining. They made them drink wine. They told the prophets, don't prophesy. They shut them up. The Nazarites had become nags, burdensome nags to the people of Israel, and they were determined to ignore God. And so as a result, Israel sought to eliminate the nuisance of these Nazarites by coercing them to drink wine, breaking their vow to God, so they wouldn't have to face that, the holiness. You know, when you get, let's just make it extreme. So you've got rough and tough, extreme, godless people, and you've got a very innocent, godly person. And when they're around, they don't like that. It makes them uncomfortable. And that's what's going on here. And so they're trying to corrupt the innocent is what's happening here. All right, so God's provided for, he saved, he's protected Israel from their oppressors in great ways, in miraculous ways, on many different times. And he lists those things out. And all that kindness, all that grace that God has shown should have motivated them to show kindness to others, to live for him. But instead, they chose to live the way of the heathen nations surrounding them. And here, toward the end of this little passage that we read, the Lord uses this emphatic personal pronoun to communicate what he has done and what he's about to do. He said, I destroyed, there in verse 9, I brought you up in verse 10, and now I will crush you. Kind of like Bill Cosby in his one of his comedy routines. I know he said it on the show as well when he's talking to Theo. He said, I brought you into this world, I can take you out, right? And that's basically what God is saying here. You know, I've sustained you and sustained you, and I'm going to crush you as well. Just as the wealthy and the powerful have been crushing the poor and the weak, the Lord's going to crush Israel. And the weight of this judgment is going to be like Israel being crushed under a cart that's just so full of grain, which is interesting because you think your cart's full of grain, that's a blessing. But it ended up too much and crushes the cart. So God, through Amos, has reminded people of their present sins, their past glory, and now he warns them of their terrible future. And in those last verses there, Amos foretold about the slaughter of Israel's army. Now remember, they're a military might. They've just gotten, you know, in recent years have defeated Judah. They're a military might there in the area. And so they're probably pretty confident in themselves. And to think some little shepherd boy from Tekoa down in the south is going to come up here and tell us, I can just see them not believing a word that they're saying. In fact, except for the day Israel's glory days of David and Solomon, they really didn't have an army, so great an army as they had during this time. So this portrayal of the army's total annihilation has got to be unthinkable to them, right? So regardless of how invincible one might think himself to be, right, pride goeth before a fall, right? God will oppose the oppressor of the poor and the powerless. We see that both in Old and New Testament, whether that's pagans acting that way or God's children doing that. No sin there will go unpunished. Every ability, every tool of war that was used in those days would fall. In fact, you see kind of a typical progression of how battle would happen. When the enemy would approach, it would be the archers that started with, you know, the long-range archers that would start and, you know, try to shoot the folks coming from afar. Next, the infantry are going to engage the attackers, you know, face-to-face. And then the commander is going to utilize his cavalry to take advantage of what he sees as the exposed weaknesses in the formations. And but as Amos described, the archers, the infantry, the cavalry, they're either going to die or attempt to flee, and that would be in vain. That's pretty heavy. That's some heavy stuff, right? They're starting off, they're listening, and they're cheering probably about the surrounding nations in Judah, and then, you know, just like a good story, the wheels turn and it comes back on them. So let's remember, just because things are going smoothly, just because finances are up, there's peace in the family, peace in the church, peace in the job, that doesn't necessarily mean that things are cool with you and God. That's not necessarily the case. And like we said earlier, why is that? Well, God, like we said, is patient, he's long-suffering, he's gracious, full of grace, and he gives us time to repent on our own, right, before the discipline comes. That's a pretty heavy note to end on, isn't it? Yeah. Well, next week, let me tell you this while I'm thinking of it. So next week, Pastor and I and Amanda and Mark and Brad Sperlin will both be up in the Spokane, Washington area on that mission trip. So Sarah Lunsford will be leading in here. I know she always does a great job. And so in 2 weeks when I come back, we're going to skip over to chapter 4. So if you want to be looking ahead and reading that, you can do that. So we'll be continuing on, and then we'll look at those other prophets here as we go through the next few weeks. Well, let me pray for us, and then we'll sing us a song or two. Lord, we thank you again very much for your word. Lord, we thank you for prophets like Amos and others who, I'm sure this was out of his comfort zone as a shepherd, to go to a land that wasn't his, to speak words of not comfort, but of condemnation. And while that is not comforting, the message here isn't comforting right now. Lord, we will eventually see, Lord, that you are a God of grace and a God of hope, even in the midst of discipline. So, Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we ask you that you would help us to recognize our sin and follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit as we walk in our daily lives. Lord, help us and strengthen us to stay true to your word, stay true to that plumb line of your word in both the things we do, the things we say, the things we think, and all that, Lord. So, again, Lord, we tell you we love you and ask these things in your name. Amen.
Well, good evening, everybody. Good to see you. I got a couple of songs. I caught the tail end there. Him speaking about grace tonight and sharing God's word about grace. So the hymn immediately came to my mind, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. This is a very powerful text, a very rich text about God's grace. And then we'll sing a song of praise to him for his grace tonight. And you are my all in all. So y'all just spend some time in the presence of God tonight as we worship him.
Yonder on Calvary.
marvelous.
Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face.
Sing grace.
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace.
You sing, you are my strength.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
You sing it tonight.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
And let's praise Him tonight as we pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you. God, you are our all in all. We thank you for your love for us tonight. God, we thank you and praise you that your grace is greater than our sin, and for keeping us in mind with that, God. We praise you tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you all for worshiping with us tonight. We're going to say goodnight to our online congregation, but you got to stay.
It's a nice way to word that, Mr. Bob.